Over the past couple of centuries, feminist reckonings highlighting the semiotic dynamics of music made by self-identified women have resulted in reflections on how these women's lived experiences have directly affected their art. In 1991, feminist musicologist Susan McClary wrote Feminine Endings, where she argued that Western music has always relied on semiotic codes of gender. Examining the structure of the sonata through the work of Beethoven, Bach, and Tchaikovsky, one of the aspects of musical tonality that draws a parallel to classical music is what McClary pinpoints as tension and release of libidinal energy. She goes on to argue that gender and sexual signifiers in music are trapped in a narrative that demands the purging and conquering of the female other, using the Freudian fear of castration as historical evidence. McClary argues, "I do not want to reduce two centuries of music to an inflexible formula, yet the heavily gendered legacy of these paradigms cannot be ignored either." McClary is not wrong. But McClary's theory was far from perfect, as feminist criticism has shifted a lot since she wrote Feminine Endings in 1991. In Elizabeth Sayre's article, Deconstructing McClary, Sayre argues that in prescribing these strictly binary male-female signifiers onto music and tonality, McClary ultimately ends up reinforcing the binary gender essentialism that her own feminist criticism aims to deconstruct, going on to say that McClary consistently uses the term woman to refer to all women, which should be problematic for any feminist theorist. There is also a big problem with McClary positing the idea of woman as a universal category, especially since we now understand gender to be a repetitive and imitative performance that is separate from biological sex. Queer theorist Judith Butler writes in Gender Trouble, "If repetition is bound to persist as the mechanism of the cultural reproduction of identities, then the crucial question emerges, what kind of subversive repetition might call into question the regulatory practice of identity itself?" While McClary's feminist music theory was not the first of its kind, contesting her work becomes difficult when the presence of critical feminist readings into music is already so sparse. Even today, attempting to dismantle the dominant Western patriarchal narrative history of art, science, and politics remains a constant struggle. The most accessible history of music is overwhelmingly white, male, and Western, and any other representation has to be meticulously combed through in order to search for something substantial from the past, especially when it comes to representations of queer women in music. However, I will give McClary credit for the important way that she highlighted the ways that music making can be a form of highlighting subjective experiences related to cultural events and identity signifiers. McClary highlighted this particularly well in her analysis of Beethoven's Ninth.
"As it tries to come to a conclusion, it keeps almost stopping and then breaking down, almost stopping, then breaking down, almost stopping, breaking down, and finally just shoving for conclusion. Beethoven is trying, in a way, to perform once again the confidence he had in the Enlightenment when he wrote the Eroica Symphony. But he is now riddled with doubt. Many things have happened in Europe and in his own life in the course of the intervening years. And so these places where the piece almost falls apart, where it is almost ripped down the middle, are as important as the places where it seems to be completely coherent."
Music can be a powerful cultural signifier, meaning that context within the personal and political events happening in an individual's life affected by their identity and the circumstances surrounding their lived experiences evidently become extremely prevalent in the music that they compose, especially for queer women. As Eric Bouchamp writes in Sound Studies, "The queer body is the site of sounds that engage pleasure, repression, rage, and isolation, always somehow outside of dominant language. Two figures who support this hypothesis are the hyperpop synth clash producer SOPHIE and the experimental composer Pauline Oliveros. The personal lives of both women and the cultural context surrounding each of their lives has informed the way that both of them made music, especially their queerness and their own unique individual experiences of womanhood. Pauline Oliveros really began hitting her stride during the women's liberation movement in the 60s and 70s, writing compositional odes to women throughout history who were dealt a poor hand of cards. Take her 1970 composition, for example, to Valerie Solanas and Marilyn Monroe in recognition of their desperation, which Oliveros composed after reading the text Scum Manifesto by Valerie Solanas, the playwright who shot Andy Warhol. The score that Oliveros composed for this particular piece was written to be an experiment in which pitch and rhythm are undecided and unspecified, requiring the piece to become an exercise in deep listening, where several performers choose five pitches, play long and drawn-out tones, and imitate the intensity of one another's pitches in what Oliveros called a continuous circulation of power, a relation that is distinctly queer and very specific to queer women. In a conversation with Martha Makis, Oliveros says, "There were rules about how to be part of that musical community in the piece so that each person could express themselves individually within the material they had, which they selected for themselves in terms of the pitches and the way that they used the pitches within three parts of the piece. If anyone became dominant, then the rest of the group would come up and absorb that dominance back into the texture of the piece. It was really out of that understanding of both community and the individual, which was in her manifesto, that became the principle or the philosophy of the music that I began to write." Here's a bit of what that sounded like. SOPHIE's quintessential album, Oil of Every Pearls on Insides, was released in 2018. Her music is known to be this abrasive, electronic synth clash form of pop that felt like a glimpse into her psyche at the time when she made it, which was in between a massive turning point in her career where she went from being a figure who people rarely ever saw to an unapologetically visible transgender icon who found herself thrust into the spotlight. It was also released in a year when trans visibility was growing, but at the same time, the trans murder rate had reached an unequivocal high. But what made SOPHIE's music truly stand out was that it transcended the organic and blurred lines between the human and the machine, something that was so out of left field and unheard of in popular music, which made her fit into this amorphous space between exhilarating liberation and also disjointed discomfort. SOPHIE has said that she is most interested in the physicality and texture of sound, building sonic architecture that imitates the sounds of whiplashes, squeaking latex, clanging metal, and fizzy pops of soda. One of the truest testaments to SOPHIE's work can be summed up in a tweet by Rose Damu, who wrote after SOPHIE's death, "She hacked the matrix. She made music that sounded like how being trans feels." With production that experimented with pitch and tone modulation, using samplers and machines to pitch the vocals up to a cartoonish chipmunk high, the transformative work that SOPHIE does with sound is exemplified in the song Face Shopping. At the beginning of the song, the spoken word lyrics go, "My face is the front of shop," which alludes to beauty as a commodity in the hyper-consumerist society that we live in. And for many trans women, their identities often come at a major cost. Lines like, "I'm real when I shop my face," draws an obvious parallel to the insane amount of pressure on a lot of trans women to perform realness, quote-unquote real femininity, by spending money on body modifications like facial feminization surgery, breast augmentation, vaginoplasty, so that they can in turn be seen by the public as quote-unquote more real. The initial speaking voice on the song soon becomes intercut with these robotic, cyborgian vocals that are so grating and distorted that it's impossible to decipher what is even being said, highlighting how frivolous and arduous the whole process can be. As Jessica Dunn Rovinelli wrote in The Guardian, transgender people in particular exist through self-processing. We make a body that we can live in, and a world where that body can feel safe. Sophie's music does that work for us, with us. We contort alongside Sophie's sounds. Our bodies mirror the music, the tools of audio processing mirror our tools for body processing. One of the quintessential tracks on the album, Immaterial Girl, invites every listener to surrender all of the gendered codes attached to their identities and imagine themselves as immaterial, genderless icons seeking a body. The gospel-sounding sample at the very beginning is the sonic equivalent of a liberating revelation with lyrics that go, "Without my legs or my hair, without my jeans or my blood, with no name and with no type of story, where do I live? Tell me, where do I exist?" In an interview with Crack Magazine, Sophie was very open and transparent about the ways that her transition caused a shift in her outlook on what genuine tangibility really is, if it even exists. In the interview, Sophie says, "There was this internal shift of just feeling like the only way I can put it is having fun in your body, seeing it as something you like and love and want to have fun with, and is going to carry you around and enable you to do things you want to do. Like a material to be manipulated. It's not like a weight you're carrying around with you that's fighting against you." What makes the work of Sophie and Pauline Oliveros so revolutionary and transformative is how it undercuts all of the missteps and prescriptive gender binaries that Susan McClary assigns to Tonality in Feminine Endings. And that is my biggest issue with Feminine Endings. McClary hardly allows any room for representations of the fluidity and fungibility of individual experiences of women, often using essentialist rhetoric to trap the female figure in the position of the cis woman who is restricted to the role of the birth giver, the victim, the muse, or the helpless damsel who only experiences desire in a singular, monolithic way. Sophie and Pauline Oliveros' music have no regard for a conventional or prescriptive gendered tonality, and their work holds up a mirror to the ways that they see the world, which allows for the polylithic and always shifting experiences of womanhood in Oliveros' case, to explore the power dynamics through communal playing by queer women, and in Sophie's case, having the freedom to create sound sculptures and manipulate voices to transcend humanity and embrace a world that is immaterial.